Well, hello, folks. How are you? Greetings to you. And thanks for tuning in, clicking play, and being with us. We are here in Schenectady, New York, at Notre Dame Bishop Gibbons Middle and High School. Now, here's a little Schenectady secret to let you in on. If anybody calls this Notre Dame Bishop Gibbons, you know they didn't go here. In Schenectady, everybody just calls it Notre Dame Bishop Gibbons High School, or in abbreviation, NDBG. But welcome everybody to this beloved Catholic school here in our Diocese of Albany. And we are at 6 feet, so the Emperor should be happy with us and won't cart us away. But there's a very big decision that needs to be made this week by government officials about receiving plans for reintegration of school districts, of private schools, and all different educational settings and environments across the state of New York. There's a lot to weigh here on everybody's minds. And if you are a parent, should I have my child remain home, or should I send my child back to school? Or maybe something in the middle. For the students, should I stay or should I go? There's a lot to weigh here, and so who better than to have our own dear people from St. Adalbert Parish, Our Lady of Mount Carmel Parish, and St. Paul the Apostle Parish speak about what it's like to weigh all of these options in the midst of the virus epidemic that we are presently experiencing. So, greetings to Nicholas and his mom Hema and his dad Mike, who are dear parishioners, the Mendoza family at Our Lady of Mount Carmel. Greetings to you.
Thank you, Father. Greetings.
Nick, what has it been like since you've been in school in this building?
It's been very boring and kind of different, very different.
Very different at home, huh?
Yep.
Oh, boy. Well, what's it like for you? Should you stay home? Should you go? How is that balance working for you in the process?
I believe I should stay home because so it can make it safe for me, my friends, and my teachers.
Yeah. Better in the long run, right? Yep. That maybe in the short run we have some difficulties or have to stay away a little longer. But in the long run, we might be better off, right?
Yes,
right? What do you think, Hema?
I'm not agreeing with sending back Nicholas to school at the moment. For the safety of himself, as he said, his friends and his teachers, teachers having to go home to their families, there's only so much that we can social distance the kids.
Right, and it's hard sometimes with the size of classrooms.
That's
the
right.
Number of students, there's a lot of factors, It's so complicated. But Marco, how about your experience? You're our dear intern this summer. How about from the Holy Cross perspective?
Yeah, so I made the difficult decision to go back. And this decision was not made lightly. I prayed a lot. I talked with my family. And ultimately, I thought this decision is the best for me. Now, it's not necessarily the best for everybody else. But if we trust in God, God has a plan for each one of us. And it is our duty as Catholics to trust in that plan, and all will be well.
Marco, you made a very good point. And it's very clear that there are decisions that are going to be different for everybody depending on their level of education that the student is going into, parents, or from all, universal pre-K all the way up to PhD program somewhere. But one thing is clear throughout any decision process, that God needs to be part of that weighing. And so we believe God is present, and we want you to understand that the good Lord is present through those rocky waters of decisions. What to do, what not to do, what's right and wrong, that's certainly not for me to say, because everybody's decision is different. Every school district is different. Every source of higher learning is different. And so lots of factors need to be considered. Just like in a parish, every pandemic safety plan is different, parish to parish too. But I'm praying for you that you make the best decision for your sons and daughters and for your loved ones who are returning to school. I'm praying for you, and our community is praying for you and all of us in this time. So God be with you, in these rough waters, may you know the still and calming words of Jesus. Be not afraid and keep hope alive in Him. Take good care, everybody. I'll see you soon. And thank you for being here, everybody. This is wonderful. Thank you. What a great school. A great, great school in the Diocese of Albany. Take care, everyone. Bye-bye. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the Lord be with you. A warm welcome, everyone, to our dear parishioners from St. Adalbert Parish, and Our Lady of Mount Carmel Parish, and St. Paul the Apostle Parish here in Schenectady, New York, and to you, wherever you may be tuning in the world today and pressing play to hear God's Word in the midst of very troubled waters, the Lord speaks to us. Before we celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us acknowledge our sins. You show us the way to peace and mercy in our lives. Lord, have mercy. You are the Son of God and Son of Mary. Christ, have mercy. You gather into one family all your scattered children. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, whom, taught by the Holy Spirit, we dare to call our Father, bring, we pray, to perfection in our hearts the spirit of adoption as your sons and daughters, that we may merit to enter into the inheritance which you have promised. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. a reading from the first book of Kings. At the mountain of God, Horeb, Elijah came to a cave where he took shelter. Then the Lord said to him, "Go outside and stand on the mountain before the Lord. The Lord will be passing by." A strong and heavy wind was rending the mountains and crushing rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake, there was fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. After the fire, there was a tiny whispering sound. When he heard this, Elijah hid his face in the cloak and went and stood at the entrance of the cave. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, I speak the truth in Christ. I do not lie. My conscience joins with the Holy Spirit in bearing me witness that I have great sorrow and constant anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my own people, my kindred according to the flesh. They are Israelites. Theirs the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. Theirs the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, is the Christ, who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
kiss my heart and my lips, Almighty God, that I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. After he had fed the people, Jesus made the disciples get into a boat and precede him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. After doing so, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When it was evening, he was there alone. Meanwhile, the boat, already a few miles offshore, was being tossed about by the waves, for the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, he came toward them, walking on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified. "It is a ghost," they said, and they cried out in fear. At once Jesus spoke to them, "Take courage, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter said to him in reply, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." Peter got out of the boat and began to walk on the water toward Jesus. But when he saw how strong the wind was and became frightened and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save us." Immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught Peter and said to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" After they got into the boat, the wind died down. Those who were in the boat did him homage, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, through the words of the Gospel. May our sins be wiped away. For those of you who are fans of professional wrestling, you will know the certain introduction by the ring announcer. "And now, ladies and gentlemen, entering the stadium from Venice Beach, California, 294 pounds, Hulk Hogan." And followed by his opponent from parts unknown, weighing 310 pounds, before his embalming, ladies and gentlemen, The Undertaker. And then the match begins. And most of us wonder, what kind of fiasco are we about to watch in pro wrestling? And you may laugh, because in the 20th century, there were small federations of wrestling promoters all across the United States. There was no big conglomerate known as WWE, World Wrestling Entertainment. And many of these promoters laughed at a man named Vincent K. McMahon, who had an idea for March of 1985 that there would be one worldwide massive event called WrestleMania, a mass event available on pay-per-view through cable boxes all across the fruited plain in the United States to watch some wrestling spectacle. And Vince McMahon put all of his money into the risk of producing WrestleMania. Again, most of the promoters of wrestling thought he was crazy, but it was worth the risk. And so in March of 1985, WrestleMania occurred, and it was the biggest wrestling event to date in the history of professional wrestling. And there is a WrestleMania every year now to show you that his risk paid off. It is the biggest wrestling corporation in the entire world. It is a publicly traded company, and you too can buy stocks in professional wrestling, should you think this is some kind of joke. But he was able to take a risk, much like the developers of Apple, Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak, out of a garage in California, willing to take a risk to put all of the marbles, if you will, into this operation. How is it that they took this risk amidst troubled waters? Because there's no guarantee that wrestling in WrestleMania would have been successful, and there certainly was no guarantee that Apple computers would be anything like it is today. But they took risks despite the storms. And that's something to reflect on today before the good Lord. There is nothing that we can do to take away storms in our lives. And I don't mean just the rain that falls down. If you're tuning in to right now to this week, you will know on Tuesday we had a massive storm, and that was rough. But there are emotional storms. There are challenges with work. There are challenges at home. There are challenges with the spiritual life that are storms. Who is walking with us on those periods of life? It is Jesus the Lord. When Peter began to doubt, and when Peter began to look down, rather than keep his eye focused on the Christ, something happened. Peter was walking on the water and then fell down. Lord, save me. What does that say to us in our own time? Does God walk with us in the midst of our risk-taking? Not that you or I are producers of a wrestling entertainment company or the next creators of the computer company of the future, but who knows? If we never take the risk with the good Lord, who can uplift us and support us, we will never know what the answer will be. Life involves risks in the midst of the storms, but it is the good Lord walking with us during those opportunities. And I use that word very carefully, not problems, but opportunities. Here comes the storm. Here comes the challenging waves, the friction of life. This is a perfect learning opportunity for you and me. An opportunity to grow in faith. For when the rockiness or the agitation of life begins and sets in, this is the time for Jesus to enter the heart and to hold our hand. To not be afraid, because he's going to let go and we're still going to make it through. We are safe in him. Imagine in our own lives, if you who are watching next to your husbands or wives never took the risk of asking her or him out on a first date, what would your life have been like? Or later on, if you never did ask for that person's hand in marriage, what would your life have been like? Suppose you look at the data of life and say that there's a greater chance of dying in an automobile accident than dying from the COVID virus, and because of that data, you decide, as a picture of being safe, that you will never step foot in an automobile ever again in your life, just to remain safe. These are interesting questions. Your life would be very different today if you did not have your current husband or wife, quite obviously. But you took a risk. But suppose in the second example that you never did take that risk ever again. And to stay safe, you're going to remain just within the walls of your house, where you believe there is no risk of any kind of danger threatening you. Be very careful, because there is no way to escape risk 100%. You are safe in spirit in Jesus. I am safe in Him by communion and by connection with Him, that no matter what harm may come to my body, that I am connected to our Savior in spirit, in communion, through the Holy Spirit, that it's okay to take that risk. We cannot predict the future, whatever it may be, with marriage, with relationships, with our jobs, with the current virus. Let me share with you some data from the California Department of Education. And there are a few viewers from California, so greetings to you now as well. From the California Department of Education, in the 2019-2020 school year, there were 6,600,000 children enrolled in public and private schools in the state of California. The total number of children of this number who have died from the current virus is zero. In the state of New York, the most recently available data, unlike California, is the 2017-2018 school year. And according to the New York State Department of Education, 3,098,000 children in public and private schools throughout the state of New York. The grand total number of people from age 15 to 24 who have died as a result of the virus is 10. Now, of course, in the age group of 15 to 24, we don't know precisely how many are within the school age or above the high school age threshold, but 10. And those data concerning deaths related to the virus are from the Centers for Disease Control. In the midst of fear about the current waves thrashing the people of God throughout the world in the midst of the virus, don't forget the big picture and also the data that we do not make decisions on fear alone, but only with the good Lord who has His eyes set on us in the midst of the storms. Nobody is saying the virus is not real, because it is, and we take our precautions. But we take them with the big picture of Jesus walking with the church, walking with you and I in the midst of the storms, not outside of Jesus' hand. Be not afraid. If we are ill or under the weather, this of course is regrettable, unfortunate, and not desired. But if it happens, we are safe in God. Do not let fear overtake communion with God. That is most important. And so I leave you with these words in the midst of troubled waters sometimes in life, from St. Augustine, who teaches the church with this knowledge. And I quote, "If I try by myself to swim across the ocean of this world, the waves will certainly engulf me. In order to survive, I must climb aboard a ship made of wood. This wood is the cross of Christ. Of course, even on board, there will be dangerous tempests and perils from the seas of this world, but God will help me to remain on board the ship and arrive safely at the harbor of eternal life. And the winner of the match will be you and me with the help of Almighty God. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please join us today in the response to these petitions. Lord, hear our prayer. For the church, realizing God's presence in our midst, that he may give us courage as we work together to build the kingdom of God, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For all persons threatened by natural disasters at this time of year, for droughts and floods, hurricanes and tornadoes, that they may be kept safe, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For those listening to God's voice as they discern their vocation in him, that they may know God's love and trust as they keep their eye on Jesus, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For everyone who struggles to recognize God's presence in their lives, that they may find encouragement and good counsel from family, friends, and from us, the believing community in Jesus, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For those whose lives have been in turmoil due to the virus, those afflicted by this illness, their caregivers who have donated time and time and all kinds of effort to serve their family members who are ill, and also all healthcare workers and essential workers who keep us safe, that they may be kept safe by the protection of God's holy angels during this time of illness, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. And for the gentle repose of the following souls, for whom I apply this Eucharist: Anne and Benedict Masiag, Domenico Falacaro, Mary Louise Massaroni, Jean Bianchi, deceased members of the Michalizzi family, Angelo DeMarco, Connie and Rocco Creatura, Daniel Brennan, Alice Cipriano, Mark Aini, and Margaret Monet, and for all who have died, that they may rest securely in the arms of the loving God, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. And for each and every one of our prayers, yours and mine, that we present at the altar of our Lord, We pray, Lord, hear our prayer. Father, give us life in the times of tumult and chaos. Guide us always by the rock of your word and your tender heart to keep us safe and to bring us home. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, O Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. Give us our spiritual drink, humble spirit and contrite hearts. May we be accepted by you, O Lord, and may our sacrifice in your sight this day be pleasing to you, Lord God. Wash me, Lord, from my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sins. We'll give you rest. My brothers and sisters, pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at my hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Be pleased, O Lord, to accept the offerings of your church, for in your mercy you have given them to be offered, and by your power you transform them into the mystery of our salvation through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Father, most holy, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your Word, through whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Savior and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin, fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people. He stretched out his hands as he endured his passion, so as to break the bonds of death and manifest the resurrection. And so with the angels and all the saints, we declare your glory, as with one voice we acclaim, Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. in a similar way. When supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Edward Scharfenberger, our bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Peace be with you, everyone. This mingling of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring eternal life to us who receive it. On us, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, who by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, through your death gave life to the world, free me by this, your most holy body and blood, from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me always faithful to your commandments. Never let me be parted from you. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. May the communion in your sacrament that we have consumed save us, O Lord, and confirm us in the light of your truth, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The saving word of God touches all people's hearts, those baptized in the Catholic Church, those baptized elsewhere, those unbaptized persons. You have tuned in. You have heard the good news of God. And God is calling for us, especially in the times of the rough waters in our lives, in the tough journeys, God is there. And may you seek the Lord while he may be found. Come join us for Mass if you desire, and if you feel safe, and if not, that's okay too. You tune in to our broadcast here on television or the internet. We will be here for you, just as the good Lord would want in these troubled times. Be not afraid, everyone, and I'll see you later. Take good care. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you.